Thanks, Jim. Now we're officially called to order. We have the minutes of April 16th, 2012.
Okay, I'll make a motion to approve.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Roll call.
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney? Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Yes.
She's getting quick. You miss that? She doesn't wait for us to answer anymore. Just move on to meeting. Okay.
We're on a time schedule here.
First, we have a moral claim at 30780 Stillwater. We referred this to the Public Works Committee, and the Public Works Committee recommended to approve the moral claim in the max amount permissible by the city. It says city code, but this is actually a city policy, Finance Committee policy. As I'm sure you're aware, the city has sovereign immunity, and it's very difficult to sue a city, but we have the municipality has the authority to pay a claim which is by law unenforceable against it, but which is in principles of just and equity constitutes a moral obligation municipality. And that's what this is. You've read the material. Do you have any questions based on what the Public Works Committee did?
No, and again, we referred to Public Works. They went through their due diligence and identified that the city did have an obligation here.
And in fact, the Public Works Committee referred it on to a city committee that looks at these issues, and they reported back, and based on that report, the Public Works made their decision.
I'll make a motion to have legislation prepared for the Moros claim at 30780 Stillwater Lane in the amount of $2,000.
Second that.
Ms.
Seconded?
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
I did have a question whether this had to go to city council, and the mayor thought it did. And I was going to check that with the law director later, just because the small amount, $2,000, I wasn't sure. But as far as the mayor knows, these do go to city council. Okay. Okay, now we have a moral claim at 34545 Bainbridge. Again, the Public Works, if I can find it here, Public Works Committee took a look at this and recommend denying the approval of this moral claim. Did not find sufficient reasons to pay this person any money. Any questions?
No, and again, we're relying on Public Works, seeing that they have their purview, their jurisdiction on this.
They went through the same process.
Right.
They referred it on to a city committee who looked at it in great detail, and basically Public Works followed their recommendation.
And there really is no need for any action taken by this committee, unless we were going to go against it.
I guess a motion by this committee to deny it, but I don't think we need legislation prepared.
All right, we'll make a motion to deny the moral claim at 34545 Bainbridge Road.
Second.
Moved and seconded.
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Okay, next, as you remember, we had a fraud policy in front of this body probably a couple months ago that we, after several meetings, approved, sent it on to council. But there were significant changes made, so it was referred back to us. We have a draft in front of us with quite a few changes. My view is that I think we need Mr. Kennedy and possibly Mr. Loby here to go through these changes with us, and that we should
right.
put this, that there's no urgency that I know of to get this passed.
Correct.
So I would recommend we put it off to our next meeting.
Sure. I have no problem with that, but in going through this, the only thing that I had a question on was the council notification. I felt that I don't think it was needed that we be necessarily notified of a situation that did come up. I think if it gets to the point where it looks like there may be charges brought, I think at that time it would be, at that time would be the most appropriate time to notify council, because I think if we start notifying at the first, when the initial claim is made, I think we start getting into where we're stepping on administration's toes, and I don't see the need for council to be involved at that time unless somebody on council is looking for control of the situation. I don't think that's really where we should be. We're a legislative body. We're not the administration.
Yeah, I agree with those comments. Arthur thinks it makes it much more difficult to keep it confidential when more people know about it.
Correct.
And I think it's more important to keep these things confidential in the early stages of the investigations.
But other than that, I like what I see, and I can understand why the changes were made.
Nancy, any comments?
I basically agree. It's maybe a little more long-winded than our original one.
What'd you say? It looks like a lawyer wrote it?
Yeah. No offense to any lawyers. But I also agree with Councilman Russo in respect to the us being notified of any sort of problems.
Okay, then, why don't we move, let's move this to our next meeting's agenda, and would you notify Mr. Kendi and Mr. Lobey that we'll be discussing it at our next meeting if they care to attend? We need at least one of them.
Well, Mr. Kennedy will be here.
I'm sure Mr. Kendi will be here. Okay. Next, I have community center fees. Don, that's you.
Yes. Excuse me.
We all saw this last, we didn't have any chance to do anything on it. Do you have any new information to add to base?
No, just, Councilman Mooney, you had contacted me about the senior rates, and I actually should have gotten you a revised copy, but if you look on your rate proposal.
Yeah.
What we'd like to do is the proposed Solon resident for the senior couple would be $235 instead of $240. That was the one that didn't have any, there was no break if they went the full year, and you were correct in that.
And that's your intent, is to give at least a small break for them going longer?
Correct.
Did you see that, this for the 12-month membership, it was just twice the six-month $120, so we reduced it by $5, give a little bit of a benefit for someone to sign for 12 months versus 6 months. And that's the only change?
That's the only change, correct.
Did you have any information what other places charge for these kinds of?
Yeah, I think, originally, I think I had sent you a memo on that, on the different, you know, each recreation center treats it differently, some of them. What I'd like to do is go into depth and detail, maybe for next year. I think we talked about this, doing it in October.
Right.
Really go through and compare some of the ones closer to Cincinnati area, Columbus, Cincinnati. Really, there's only a couple here that are community centers in the area, and there's really only one that's really close to us, and that's Westlake, that is really of any comparison. So I'd like to do, like, Dublin's is pretty close to ours, you know, in size and scope, and maybe check out, specifically, number of people and how they charge for maybe more than four in a family or things like that.
Okay.
So for now, this would be, you know, through the end of the year, actually would start probably October, and actually carry us through next year. So we do have a little bit of time on this.
Okay. The other question I had, you have a number of places where you have kind of one person under a plan. Healthy Solon and only nine-member non-member aid card. Why would we have things that would have so few people signing up for? I hate to develop programs for, you know, a very small number of people.
Sometimes those programs may have been discontinued, actually. And some of them only run at special times, like the Healthy Solon only ran for a certain time when we were doing events. We actually ran where there was a weight loss program, and we wanted to get these people in here, so that was kind of like a special pass, and we really only had one person sign up for that.
Okay.
But it was made available so that they could join that program.
I see. Okay. Questions?
I just have one question.
Yes, sir.
You do the change of the fee change in July, is that correct?
Actually, we were looking not until October we would do it.
Oh.
Only because the reason I wanted to do it, because I want to get it into our next brochure so that people are aware of it.
Okay.
And there's some things that we allow residents to do. They can actually tack on. If they want to renew before that rate goes up, we let them do that, okay. You know, kind of give them a break so that they actually, you know, if there are 3 months left on their pass, we'll actually let them do that so that they do catch a break. And we try to be as fair as possible when we do that.
That was going to be my question. Is, you know, I know mine is the anniversary of when I first got it.
Sure.
And I assume everybody else's is the same. If you got it in
November, usually pretty
then
close, right?
Okay,
right.
So you would though?
Absolutely.
Okay. Okay.
So this generally goes for a year. Is that October to October? Is that the normal process on when you redo fees?
Yeah.
Okay. Then if we wanted to look at it again, it should probably be in the spring next year. If you want to talk about how other Westlake does it, for example, and look at fees.
Correct.
Because,
you know, just to give, it would probably have to be done as part of the budget process. It may end up being end of this year, because we really should do it as part of the budget process.
So October, that's why the October time.
Yeah.
Okay, then can we add this to the October meeting discussion of the fees? Okay, so this does not need legislation. All it needs is Finance Committee approval. I got one more question for that.
Sure.
Don, in Grantwood, we had to give you approval for special rates. obviously because of weather or things like that. Do you need anything like that in recreation?
It probably wouldn't hurt, you know, in case that we do have special circumstances. It probably is not a bad idea. I mean, would you like me to, I can write a memo on that, and we can do that next month? There's no, I don't think there's any.
We can include it on the motion now. Again, my only requirement is that we get notified periodically if you do special things, just so we can keep track of it.
And just so you're aware, on this, actually, I do have to get council approval.
You do, okay.
Only because this, the fees were actually part of the policies and procedures of the community center when we first opened the center, and that took council action. So I was always told by the law director that because it was made with council action, any changes need to go before council. So the community center fees are a little bit different than any of my other rec fees.
Okay. I guess we do need legislation.
I'll make a motion to approve, to prepare legislation to approve the community center fees as outlined in Mr. Howell's memo, of which date?
April 6, 2012.
April 6, 2012.
Second.
Moved and seconded?
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
It's done. Next is, I don't know where I have the extra page. Fund closure and transfer. Mr. Kennedy isn't here, but I thought the memo was pretty straightforward. Anybody have any questions or issues with this one?
No.
Made sense to me.
Okay. Then I'll make a motion to prepare legislation for council to approve the elimination of Fund 709, which is the payroll accrual clearing, PAC fund, and transfer any balances left in this fund to the general fund.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Just before we do it, just to let people know, this is a fund that has a balance of a little over $3,000. There's been no activity in this fund since, was it the mid-1990s, so it's just a matter of cleaning up these things. Mr. Kennedy's going through this kind of one at a time and trying to simplify the process. So this is just another step along that way. Okay, moved and seconded?
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Okay, Home Days Equipment Bid Tab. Don?
Yes, I believe you have a memo from Russ Schneider concerning this.
Yes, we do.
This one is a little bit different in that I think every year we've bid, we actually have only had one bidder. And the reason for that is it's such a big event that it's tough for anybody else to be able to handle it. We've had Able Rents ever since I've been here, actually ever since we started Home Days. So unfortunately, they've been the lone bidder each year. I'm not sure that any other company in the Cleveland area is big enough to do it. Especially at this price, but again, plus the fact we it's a little bit different this year in that we are actually setting some of the tents up a week early in order to accommodate Karen's event. Actually, we have Karen's event, and then we have the next day, I think we have a Rotary event taking place at the park, so they will be well used as far as the tents go. But Able Rents did submit a bid in the amount of $24,912. What's been done in the past is that everything is done. Anything over and above that, we would need your approval for up to 20%, I believe you're allowed, over that price, and they will handle that on a per-case basis. So if we need more if we have more exhibitors than what we thought in here, we would just do it on a tent-by-tent basis.
How does this bid price compare to last year's? Do you remember that by any chance?
It's about 15 to 20% higher, but that's because of some of the other events, like there are two very, very large tents that are going to be up for about a week, week and a half, versus just having them up for 3 or 4 days.
Okay. Mayor?
And just to be clear with the Rotary event, they are, anything that would exceed what our cost would have been, they are covering that cost. So I don't want people to think the city's covering for a private organization. So we just included them in the bid. And then whatever Karen had, and remember both of those events, I made a motion at Roundtable probably 1 or 2 months ago to declare both of those a public purpose to cover that as well, just because of any employees that may be working on the grounds that day. So we're not incurring any more costs for those events, so I just want that to be clear.
All right, are there any questions?
I have one question. What is equipment? I mean, tents, tables?
They actually have, they bring out electrical cords, lights, things like that.
Okay. And basically, when somebody rents
would rent a space, I mean, some of that money then would go back toward the cost of all of this, correct?
Correct.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
And then this request is in line with what we've done in prior years. I mean, the 20% over
Home Days,
above,
and right. Just so everybody's aware, Home Days is basically a break-even proposition. Mm-hmm. You know, usually, I believe we still have about $30,000 to $40,000 in the fund. When council used to give us about $10,000 per year, we have not used that money in probably the past 4 or 5 years because it is a break even now. So,
mm-hmm. Great.
Okay. I'll make a motion to have legislation prepared to accept the bid of Able Rental for equipment for the Solon Home Days.
I'll second that.
Seconded.
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Ben? Grantwood Pro Shop.
You should have a memo there with a request for a purchase order for a company that's called Acushnet. They actually represent two different companies, which would be Titleist, which is well known in golf, and also FootJoy. The reason that we're requesting council authorization is because the purchase order is over the $15,000 limit. One of the things that we did this year at Grantwood in order to simplify is we're actually just selling one brand of golf ball, and it's actually a Titleist golf ball. They do have a couple different brand names under that logo, but Titleist, what they do is they offer to anybody that is exclusively a Titleist dealer, there's 10 to 15% in discounts for the golf balls. What we did is we went back to previous years, and between 85 and 90% of our golf balls sold are Titleist golf balls. We're kind of getting the golf balls out of there that are drained on inventory and, you know, saving the city money at the same time. That's one of the reasons why the purchase order is up above that. And also is because of the equipment and the athletic wear. So that the $40,000 covers all FootJoy and Titleist materials, which actually they sell differently.
It's 40, it's 30,000.
Right? Actually, it's 30. Yeah. Correct, I'm sorry. But that covers both the Titleist and the FootJoy, which are all covered under a cushion at its one name. But they sell, we have different reps and everything for that, so.
I mean, I think that's good work on the golf balls. That makes a lot of sense to me. And Titleist does make number one selling golf ball, and they mm-hmm. make a whole variety of golf balls from the duffer to the very good player. So I think you can still satisfy all your customers and make more money. So that's a good move. What I didn't understand, though, are you saying we're going to be exclusive on FootJoys also?
No.
Okay.
There's no exclusivity with any of the other brands. It's just that they are both one and the same, and they have to go under the same purchase order because okay. it is the same company.
So the only exclusivity you're talking about is the golf ball?
Correct.
All right.
Correct.
And what other – this is for $30,000 to a cushion, and you clearly have a lot of other vendors.
Right. As a matter of fact, I believe I had to have signed it. I think there were three others that I actually had to get signed through City Council, and I think I needed two signatures. One of them would have been Ping. We do sell a lot of Ping equipment. They're more equipment. Callaway, and the last one escapes me, and I'm sorry. Might have been TaylorMade was the fourth one. So we do sell with other vendors, and even with those vendors, and I should say that these are not to exceed numbers. If we don't sell, we won't buy anymore. You know, it's one of those things. I imagine with the golf balls, especially with the year that we're having, that will go. But if we don't sell the equipment, we don't bring new equipment in until that's sold. But this covers us so that, you know, we don't run out of equipment in the store and then have to come back to you, you know, in the future and ask for another amount.
Did you find last year was you could get rid of the stuff towards the end of the year? I mean, what I get worried about is we carry stuff for a long time and it's not sellable anymore.
Yeah, actually, you know, matter of fact, it's funny because you mentioned turnover. We talked about turnover.
Right.
We're finding that this year, what a difference a year makes. Last year, if you remember, we really didn't get started until April or May,
right.
Both with buying inventory, getting it out so the public knew about it. Our numbers this year, I think we ended up with $65,000 to $70,000 in business last year. We're probably at about $35,000 to $40,000 already this year.
That's a good
start.
Okay. Any questions, any concerns
nope.
about this?
Nope.
No. Makes sense to me. Okay, do I have a motion?
Sure, I'll make a motion that, do we have to prepare legislation for?
Yes.
Yes.
Make a motion to prepare legislation to authorize Grantwood Pro Shop to enter into a purchase order agreement with Kushnet up to not to exceed $30,000.
Second.
Moved and seconded.
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thanks, Don. Karen, welcome.
Thank you.
You're going to be a regular visitor here. We appreciate that.
Glad to be here.
Okay, the first one we have is Phil Dirt and the Dozers.
Yes, it's for the June 29th.
Can you sing one of their songs to just remind us what they sound like?
No, my staff refuses to let me do it anymore.
Oh, okay.
I have my own words. I've made up for it and everything. But this is Phil Dirt and the Dozers and the concerts with Solon Philharmonic. And it is the first event of the Cuyahoga Arts and Culture Grant. And it's at June 29th, 7:30 at the high school football stadium. So I'm requesting final payment for their contract to approve the $5,000.
And how did that work? We have the money from the grant already, and it's sitting in one of our funds, or?
Not yet. In fact, I just today I'm $10 short of being able to apply for the 60% of funding. The 60% is about $19,000-$20,000 through the Signature Club memberships. They're coming in the mail right now, so I'm $10. I'm about ready to put the $10 in myself so I can get this done. but we have the commitment from friends for $12,500, and then we also have in the next item the $5,000 from an anonymous trust that also goes towards the grant.
Okay. All right, so the grant is guaranteed.
Yes, at this point. Yes.
Yeah, Nancy?
I have a question. I was a little confused, Karen. Maybe it's just me. You had in your final payment $5,000, so they've already received 25?
I have not received that check yet, but Dennis had authorized the $2,500 down payment. The PO is in. I haven't seen the check yet, so.
Okay. I just was wondering if the total was then
$7,500, yes.
So it's $7,500 yes, we're going to be
for the
paying.
Band.
And you pay them ahead of time, the band?
Just the, just it's just request for approval for the
okay,
$5,000.
So
the PO is not in yet, so
okay,
that won't happen until the night of the concert.
Okay.
But the $2,500 is the deposit.
Deposit, okay, gotcha. Okay, that's what I thought.
Hey, do you need legislation on this? It's only $5,000. I would think that.
I don't.
Do you know?
She'll need two signatures.
Yeah, I think all you need is two signatures. If,
okay. All right. So just do the PO as normal.
Right.
Through Dennis. Okay. All right.
Yeah. Right.
Okay.
And then get two committee chairmen to sign, and you're done.
Great.
And I don't think, did anybody here have any issues with this?
No.
No. Not at all.
Thanks.
It looks great. I can't wait.
Thanks. It's going to be fun.
All right. Okay. Next one. Even better news, we're actually getting money on the next one. So you want approval to accept two donations?
Yes, the first one is the approval to accept some equipment that is actually being donated by friends for the theater from this anonymous trust, that the funds were raised by friends. And the equipment has been listed in the memo that I sent you. This is equipment that's a little bit outdated. Some microphones need replacement. There's some lighting equipment. So it's $5,000 worth of equipment in the theater that only make the productions better. So
you don't use it all. You'll use some of it, and it'll be worthwhile.
Oh, yes, absolutely. And then the other $5,000 is the one that I mentioned that is actually through this anonymous trust that goes towards the cost of Solon Philharmonic through the grant. So.
Any questions?
Nope.
Just, I guess, a question for Fred. I know later we talk about setting up an account for the project they want to do over there. Where do things like this donation of $5,000, does it go right into the?
We have a grant fund we set up some years back, Fund 766, mm-hmm. And this will go into that grant because then we show all the expenses when they report to get their reimbursement.
So all grants go into that, and you keep track of by which department received
right,
it?
Right, this art center has its own grant.
Oh, art center has its own grant, okay. Okay, this does not need legislation either, I would think, just a motion saying that we approve.
I'll make a motion to approve and accept the donation to the Solon Center for the Arts.
For the equipment and the
$5,000? Yeah, for the equipment and for the $5,000 check from the anonymous donor.
Thank you.
I'll second that.
Moved and seconded.
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
It's
going
to be a good summer, Karen.
Busy, that's for
busy
sure.
Busy summer. Well, that's good. Thank you. And we get to, Dennis isn't here again, but it looks fairly straightforward. He wants to find, how, use a fund they can put this money in for the patio project, keep it separate. Makes a lot of sense to me. If it helps him do his, him and Fred do their job better. Anything you want to add to that, Fred?
Yeah, that, we discovered that we set up, formally set up a donation account for the bricks in the Art Center grant fund. We didn't want to commingle that money because the bricks doesn't have anything to do with the grant. So we thought it was best to move that money into the Old City Hall renovation fund, which has some residual money, maybe $1,500 or so left in it, which they're using to replace a door or something like that. So that'll take care of that, but the brick money will go in there. And then any other donations and whatever they do for their patio project will also go, so it'll be segregated in the Fund 476 for the patio only.
Can we rename the fund just so that it makes sense? What, can we call it the Art Center Patio Fund? Is that?
You can do whatever you want with the fund, yeah. I mean, but like I said, there is some residual that you put in this memo that, you know, is pretty kind of earmarked that we will spend out that's sitting there. Like I said, maybe $1,800 somewhere, $1,800. But the brick donations are right now are around, I don't want to say $8,800, maybe $9,000 they've taken in the last 2 years. So we'll move that out of the grant fund in over there. And I mean, if it's your pleasure to rename it, that's fine.
What do you think? I'd rather rename it just so when you look at it, you know what the money's for.
I mean, that was the Old City Hall, though.
But I mean, over time, it's been used for multiple.
Oh, I see, you're right. I forgot about that, right.
Yeah. Right.
That building was the Old City Hall.
I have no problem with keeping the name.
Yeah, you're right. That name still works.
Yeah.
Okay. I take that back. So we do need legislation on this one.
I'll make a motion to prepare legislation to designate the use of Fund 476, the Old City Hall Renovation Fund, to receive any revenue and to generate relative to the efforts to fund improvements for the patio area of the Solon Center for the Arts.
Second.
Moved and seconded.
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Okay, we're doing the time reports. Fred, Dennis wrote a fairly extensive memo on the income tax receipts through April of 2012 and gave us a lot of history. Anything you'd want to say about that?
No, we're just happy to report that the revenue is keeping a good pace and knock on wood, I guess.
I mean, you look at it, clearly January, we were a little worried after January because we were
right
down. But February, March, and April have been the best months ever for income tax, withholding tax. Mm-hmm. The year to date is the best ever. Second best was last year, and third best was back in 2007 before the recession.
Right.
The only area that seems like we're struggling a little bit on is, was it individual tax that was
right
down? Mm-hmm. That's a relatively small number compared to the withholding tax. So we look like we're in decent shape. We're going to meet the budget projections at least at this point. Lots of things can still happen, but looks better than it did a few months ago.
Correct.
So I thought that was very good news, and I appreciated the report. I could pass it on to Mr. Kennedy. Something I will keep. The other thing I'd like to talk about rescheduling this meeting. We've had problems having it late in the year. Both Nance and I tend to travel a lot that time of the year. I did talk to Carol, and she said a date that's available would be the third Wednesday of the month. There's Safety and Public Property is the second Wednesday, Public Works is the first Wednesday, third Wednesday is available, and this committee actually used to meet on the third Wednesday of the month. It was changed, I don't know, probably a previous finance director changed it. You know anybody like that, Mayor? It was a long time ago. So when you were there, it was Thursdays? Oh, okay. So I guess a long time ago. So my preference would move it to the third Wednesday of the month. How do you two feel about that?
I have no problem.
Yeah, I'm very agreeable to that.
I did talk to Mr. Kennedy. He said it was okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay with you two?
I'll just make my announcements for the third Wednesday
okay with you,
of the
Sue?
Month from now.
Since you're our only audience regular member, we got to make sure you can come. Yeah, so I'll make a motion that we'll move the finance meeting starting next month to the third Wednesday of the month.
Second.
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Anything else? Fred, do you have anything else?
No, everything's good.
Barbie, were you going to add something or you got to add to the agenda?
No. We took care of it in 5A.
That was the agenda item, okay. Anything else?
No.
And I'll make a motion to end this meeting.
Ms. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Mooney?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Just for the record.
Barb's getting quick. She likes this pace, doesn't she?